lens flare, weather balloons, optical illusions, swamp gas. 95% of all UFO sightings can be explained and quickly discredited. But 5% have enough eyewitnesses and factual evidence that they demand to be taken seriously. Journalist Leslie Kane has been researching these cases for over 10 years, focusing on the most credible evidence and witnesses.
I've worked with high-level officials, pilots, generals, and a former U.S. governor to show that there is a physical phenomenon that exists.
A huge triangular object,
dark gray oval.
Now, new evidence, audio recordings, radar data, and never-before-heard witness testimony make these sightings part of the select 5% that is impossible to ignore.
Time to correct the record once and for all.
The large majority of UFO reports are made by civilians in isolated cases with one or two corroborating witnesses and can be easily dismissed.
Here he comes from the south. He's coming toward us now. That's not real.
But when a sighting occurs over a nuclear-armed American military base at the height of the Cold War and is seen by 60 Air Force personnel for 45 minutes, it demands closer scrutiny.
Here we have a senior officer making a report of a UFO directly over the most important base in the whole NATO network, and there's no response to him. I found that absolutely astounding.
Now, 30 years later, key witnesses have come forward to tell their remarkable story.
The team and witnesses were told to treat the investigation as top secret, and no further discussion would be allowed.
This is the extraordinary incident at Rendlesham Forest.
My name is Colonel Charles Hult. In 1980, I was the deputy base commander at RAF Bentwaters Woodbridge, England. At that time, Bentwaters was the largest tactical fighter wing in the free world. And our mission as a key NATO installation was to be prepared should anything happen. Early in the morning of the 26th of December, I went in to collect the police blotters. That's the chronological list of what happened the previous 24 hours. And as I walked into the office, the on-duty desk sergeant started to laugh. He said, "Colonel, you're not going to believe this. Last night, three of our policemen were out in the forest chasing UFOs. They called in and thought they saw a downed aircraft. They went out and investigated, and they had some type of an experience." I said, "We'll put something into the blotter to the effect that they saw some lights, and we'll leave it at that for now."
Hult plans for the UFO story to go away, despite growing rumors around the base about a strange craft seen in the woods on Christmas night. But within days, he is forced to act.
Two nights later, we were having the Christmas party, and we were just finishing the main course and getting ready for dessert when the on-duty flight lieutenant cornered the base commander and I and said, "We have to talk. The UFO is back." I was sure I could put this thing to rest. So I took my little pocket recorder, which I carried everywhere, an APN 27, which is a Geiger counter, and we went out into the forest.
Late in the evening on December 27th, 1980, Colonel Hult takes a team of four officers, including a flight commander and a disaster preparedness expert, out to the site where the alleged craft had landed two nights earlier.
And lo and behold, I find half our security force out there. Five, six, seven vehicles, jeeps, six passenger pickup trucks, and they're trying to light up the forest. Here I'm thinking, this is a public relations disaster just waiting to happen. So I tell them to knock it off, get as many people and things back to the base as they can. And with a little tape recorder, I took a small team into the forest to the alleged landing site.
We found a small blast. It looks like a scuffed up area here. We got very positive readings to see. Is that near the center? Yes, it is.
Hult and his team locate three indentations in the shape of a triangle at the alleged landing site.
What kind of readings we got, eh?
Let's go to 7 tenths, yeah.
7 tenths, right here in the center?
The radiation readings are 10 times the normal or background level, signaling that there is definitely more to the sighting than Hult at first allowed.
We find rub marks on the trees facing the site and quite a few broken branches on the ground. And when we looked up, we noticed a break in a tree canopy above us. It was obvious something had come up through or down through the trees. As we're investigating, we also hear the barnyard animals, the cows and the chickens, sort of went into a frenzy for a short period of time and then got very silent. And then somebody suddenly notices a glowing red object on the far side of the forest. And I immediately turn my tape recorder back on. As Holt and his team race to get closer, the details of the object come into focus. It was oval. This was all reddish orange. And there were like pieces of molten metal dripping off it, and they were falling to the ground. It had a black-like center. This was solid black. And this would actually like blink, almost like an eye. It moved horizontally through the trees, about 4 to 6 feet off the ground, zigzagging, bobbing up and down a little bit, as though they were searching for something, and it definitely was under some type of intelligent control.
Holt's description matches many other sightings of UFOs. Witnesses often report red orbs that dart and search as if under intelligent control. But for Holt and the other officers, their experience is about to become anything but typical.
We watched it for probably 2 or 3 minutes, and suddenly it silently exploded into 5 white objects and everything disappeared. Well, this really puts us all but in shock. I'm thinking, I'm never going to be able to explain this. People will never believe this. This is just too bizarre. Well, somebody in the party looks to the north and said, look, what's that? And we see 4 or 5 objects that are elliptical with multicolor lights, probably 3 or 4,000 feet in elevation, and they're moving at high speed with sharp angular movements. We hear a lot of chatter on the radios, and we were having difficulties the whole time, too. There was a lot of interference. Some say that sending down a beam into the weapon storage area, and we were all extremely nervous about what was happening. Suddenly, one comes overhead and stops. It sends down a beam at our feet. When the beam came down, we stood perfectly still. I don't think anybody moved. Everybody just stood there in shock. And it's going through my mind, there has to be some type of a reason for this. Is this a communication? Is this a weapon? Is this a warning? What do we do now?
Holt and his men are transfixed by the craft looming overhead. The sight is something unfamiliar to these trained military professionals.
Never seen anything like it. And while we're standing there, just as suddenly as it appeared, click, it's gone. I'm thinking, there is no real explanation for all of this. Why did I get involved? This is not exactly career enhancing.
Over 60 Air Force personnel are reported to have seen a UFO during the 2 nights that comprised the Rendlesham incident.
According to witnesses, this really shook up the base. This was during the Cold War. This was a nuclear-armed outpost, and it was an incursion, a national security concern to both the British and the Americans.
As the commanding officer on duty, Holt is required to report the events to his superiors, so he files a brief memo, hoping to put the matter to rest. Due to the base's location within England, the memo is forwarded to the British Ministry of Defense, which quickly concludes that the event is of no defense significance and closes the case. And it would remain that way for over a decade.
My name's Nick Pope. I worked for the Ministry of Defense for 21 years, and for much of the early 90s, I ran their UFO project. My job was to investigate sightings and determine whether there was evidence of any potential threat to the United Kingdom.
In 1994, Nick Pope instigates a cold case review of the Rendlesham Forest incident.
One of the things that prompted me was the apparent lack of any formal response to Colonel Holt's report. Here was one of the most senior officers ever to go on the record, making a report of a UFO landing in close proximity to two of the most important bases in the whole NATO network, and there's no response to him. I found that absolutely astounding.
Pope begins an exhaustive three-year study, uncovering several key errors in the investigation, including a confusion over jurisdiction.
The Rendlesham Forest incident involved the twin bases Bentwaters and Woodbridge. Now, of course, these were United States Air Force bases, but on British soil. So there was total confusion about who was in charge. Another problem was that the landing site had not immediately been cordoned off. People were coming and going, contaminating the site. It should have been searched thoroughly with a metal detector. Soil samples should have been taken. This didn't happen.
Years into his review, Pope uncovers one of the most critical failures of the original investigation.
I was looking at the question of whether or not the UFO was tracked on radar. One of the witnesses said that for an instant there was an uncorrelated target that was hanging over the bases for about two or three sweeps of the radar, and then it disappeared. But when the Americans made the report to the UK, the date was wrong. So, of course, the Ministry of Defense were looking at the wrong night. And by the time we realized the error, the radar tape had been destroyed. The original investigation had been fatally flawed.
But Pope would go further than simply detailing the failures of the original investigation. Soon he would encounter an eyewitness who came close enough to touch one of these remarkable craft and produce striking images of a landed UFO unlike any he had seen before.
It was very clear to me that we did have solid evidence that an unidentified object or objects was operating over the UK.
Just after Christmas in 1980, over 60 Air Force personnel witnessed what they describe as multiple unknown craft over the twin NATO bases, Bentwaters and Woodbridge, England. The experience rattles the soldiers, including Deputy Base Commander Colonel Charles Holt.
I'm thinking, I'm never gonna be able to explain this. People will never believe this. This is just too bizarre.
The sighting is never officially explained, leaving the witnesses to question what they believe they saw. Until a decade later, when Nick Pope, a British Ministry of Defense official in charge of UFO investigations, instigates a cold case review of the now infamous sightings.
It was soon clear to me that the original investigation had been fatally flawed.
Troubled by these failures, Pope takes his investigation deeper. In 1994, he interviews a man who would become a key witness in the case, Sergeant James Peniston, the senior American airman in charge of security.
2 days before Colonel Holt's sighting, Sergeant Peniston had also seen the UFO, and he and two other airmen had actually approached this object, and he got close enough to produce some spectacular drawings. Peniston clearly got very close. See the essentially triangular shape here. And it's interesting to note that indentations were found at the landing site in the shape of a triangle. And peak radiation readings were recorded in those three indentations.
As the three of us got closer to the craft, we started experiencing radio difficulties. The air around us was electrically charged, and we could feel it on our clothes, our skin, and our hair. Nothing in my training prepared me for what I was witnessing.
Sergeant Peniston observed the craft for nearly 45 minutes.
One of the most intriguing pieces of information were strange symbols that he saw on the side, which he said reminded him a bit of Egyptian hieroglyphs. And he sketched this in his police notebook.
Many years after the incident, Sergeant Peniston decides to step out of the shadows, speak publicly about his sighting.
Over 80 Air Force personnel, all trained observers, witnessed the takeoff. The team and witnesses were told to treat the investigation as top secret, and no further discussion would be allowed.
I think in looking back at the Rendlesham Forest incident, it was very clear to me that we did have solid evidence of a compelling UFO case, that an unidentified object or objects was operating over the UK.
The Rendlesham Forest incident is now considered one of the most conclusive UFO sightings in history and includes several archetypal characteristics seen in the most credible UFO cases. Triangular and disc-shaped craft that move silently and accelerate instantly to unknown speeds.
It stands as a benchmark against which all other UFO cases can be measured. And when you add in all the cases that involve high-level military people, government officials, pilots, cases that have been officially investigated, you have a body of evidence that simply can't be ignored.
But what happens when an entire city witnesses a UFO reported to be as large as 2 or 3 football fields?
It was the shape of a boomerang.
A large black object coming right towards us.
I thought I was going to pass out because I was so enthralled in looking at this thing.
And I said, that's a mile long.
In 1997, thousands in Phoenix, Arizona witnessed an enormous craft.
Do these lights belong to visitors from outer space?
UFO was being blasted all over the television, so people were going outside of their houses and looking up in the sky.
Now, new evidence is introduced in one of the most enduring UFO cases in history.
All hell broke loose, basically, and we had a complete lockdown.
Official explanations are dissected.
The Air Force stated that flares were dropped around 10 p.m., but witness reports came in over an hour before the flares were dropped. So using that excuse makes a mockery out of what thousands of people said they saw.
And a former governor reveals his startling admission.
I knew more about the lights over Phoenix than I let on.
This is the Phoenix Lights.
I'm Fife Symington, the former governor of Arizona, and in the spring of 1997, there was a very unusual event that occurred while I was the governor. I guess some people refer to it as the lights over Phoenix.
It was Thursday night, March 13th, 1997, 8:30 p.m.
My daughter Monica came running in to say there was something coming over the end of Camelback Mountain, and so 4 of the kids got up, ran out, and I ran out with them.
And I looked to the north, my wife and I saw 3 bright white lights in triangle formation coming right towards us.
It had 5 big lights in front, and it was the shape of a boomerang.
It was a solid craft, silent, very low to the ground. And the thing that took me was the size. Profoundly enormous, profoundly massive. I mean, we don't even have shopping centers this big.
We stood and watched it come, and it floated directly over our house. And it was probably 5 to 6 minutes that we had full view of this.
My wife and I, we just stared at each other. And I looked her right in the eye and I says, we just saw our first UFO.
Do these lights belong to visitors from outer space? Hundreds of people across the valley think it's a distinct possibility.
What is described as a giant, brightly lit boomerang soars through the air.
No official explanation of those strange bright lights.
That night, it was being blasted all over the radio, all over the television, so people were going outside of their houses and looking up in the sky, and it was being viewed by thousands of people across the valley. There were barrages of phone calls coming into the governor's office and to the Department of Public Safety. People wanted answers. So, of course, I was making my inquiries immediately to the head of the National Guard. And I had members of my staff calling Luke Air Force Base to find out if they were flying some exotic aircraft over the valley and not really getting any answers. I mean, everybody was just sort of, oh my gosh, well, we don't know what it is.
Something strange happened in the skies over Arizona that still hasn't been fully explained.
It's something UFO enthusiasts are calling a major sighting. Pilots report seeing it in the air, yet military radar screens pick up nothing.
Whatever it was, it has more than a few Phoenicians watching the skies tonight.
Well, in the weeks following the incident, over 700 witnesses called in reports to local officials and to the National UFO Recording Center, a private organization in Seattle, Washington. And these witnesses included pilots, police officers, and military professionals.
Although descriptions of the craft differ, several overriding characteristics prevail. It is a massive solid object, not merely lights. in the shape of a delta or triangle. And it makes no noise as it moves over the valley. Most importantly, it is viewed from multiple vantage points by witnesses across the county for a total of 106 minutes.
We literally were laying down on the grass looking up at it.
It was a solid, solid object.
Something that I'll never explain.
Real deal.
It was a major UFO event seen by thousands of people across the state of Arizona. And they were expecting a serious response from the government.
Well, you can imagine the building hysteria that was going on in our community about what really happened and what we were going to do about it.
I'm going to order a full, you know, investigation of this through DPS. We're going to make all the necessary inquiries, and we're going to get to the bottom of it. We're going to find out.
I was probing and trying to get answers, but everybody was sort of denying that they saw it in official channels, which really had me perplexed. And Councilwoman Barwood really took the lead. She called Senator John McCain, and the senator was the first person to get something out of the Air Force.
The Air Force tells Senator McCain that the lights are high-intensity flares, dropped by the National Guard between 9:30 and 10 p.m. But since the sightings began at 8:15 p.m., over an hour before the flares were dropped, and in a different part of the city than the UFO was seen, this fails to explain what many witnesses saw.
They were all shot right around 10 o'clock at night. They were all southwest of Phoenix. They weren't even over the city or even in the county. What my wife and I saw happened at 8:30.
Seems to me this big object came over at 8:30. The authorities decided they better do something to cover it up, so they had a flare show at 10.
Well, it was an intentional diversion, yes.
What's really confusing is that the lights that were shown on TV that night were actually the flares.
Do these lights belong?
Because the news footage was taken at 10 p.m. when the flares were dropped.
Strange dots of light that were the top of
But that doesn't explain what all the witnesses saw. The flares were dropped over 2 hours after the sightings began. These were two separate events.
Casting further doubt on the Air Force's explanation, is this never-before-heard recording of a call made by an airman at Luke Air Force Base to the National UFO Reporting Center early in the morning on March 14th.
Apparently, we got a call from Prescott Valley Airport, a small airport north of us, reporting an object that had a near miss with a small Cessna. The call came up approximately 8:32 that they encountered something over Phoenix, Arizona, over the area of 7th Avenue and Indian School Road. They don't know what it was.
According to the airmen, Luke Air Force Base launched two F-15s to investigate the incident shortly after 8:30 p.m. He spoke with one of the F-15 pilots after their return, describing him as visibly shaken.
The command pilot of this particular flight, I've never seen this man scared. And he was scared to death. He's not sure what it was. His statement was that they followed this aircraft. It went on a straight line course heading towards Sky Harbor Airport, which is one of our main airports here, at approximately 18,000 feet, descending to 10,005. He saw five distinct lights in a triangular pattern. First three lights were in a tight triangular formation, and then the other light was at about 400 yards, also on the east side of the triangle. It scared the hell out of them. And after they landed, the base was, we had a complete lockdown. All hell broke loose, basically, and the facility was closed.
Despite the shocking testimony, the Air Force categorically denies the encounter. But like the Rendlesham case before it, official attempts to dismiss the sightings are unsuccessful.
It was the story that wouldn't go away, and the governor knew he would have to address it.
Governor Fife Symington is determined to find out what those lights are all about.
Soon the Phoenix lights would reach national prominence as Governor Symington reveals his astonishing news.
I knew more about the lights over Phoenix than I let on.
To escort the accused into the room so that we may all look upon the guilty party.
It's time to correct the record once and for all. But when you serve in public office, you have to be very careful dealing with sensitive, incendiary subjects like UFO sightings.
Well, I'm going to order a...
The fact of the matter is, if you're a public official and you start talking about UFOs, you really get attacked. It's unbelievable.
So we start tonight with those strange dots of light.
First, the left side...
In 1997, thousands witnessed a UFO over Phoenix. Reports described a delta-shaped craft, several football fields in length, Like the craft at Rendlesham, it was viewed from multiple vantage points by witnesses across the county for a total of 106 minutes.
Thousands of people saw it, and it was quite a buildup of public interest, almost close to hysteria.
UFO enthusiasts all over the country.
3 months after the sighting, USA Today features the Phoenix Lights on its front page, forcing Governor Symington into the spotlight.
In early June, there was some major publicity, and all of a sudden, we found ourselves sort of besieged. So I organized this press conference to try to get people to kind of climb off the emotional mountain a bit.
On June 19th, Symington holds a news conference to announce the mystery has been solved.
And now I'll ask Officer Stein and his colleagues to escort the accused into the room so that we may all look upon the guilty party. Don't get him too close to me, please. Now, this just goes to show that you guys are entirely too serious.
It really was a very funny spoof, but unfortunately it was taken the wrong way.
It was an insult, and I'm greatly offended, as are many, many witnesses, because a lot of people could have came forward, but instead they became reclusive. They refused to talk about it because of this, because of the ridicule.
I was angry over it because I know what I saw, and I did not like that kind of attitude. When this thing was over my house for 5 minutes, someone should care. Someone should care.
That press conference, it really did upset a lot of people, and I regret that. But what really bothered me was that I knew more about the lights over Phoenix than I let on. And I should have talked more openly about my own experience sooner. On March 13th, I was having dinner with my family. We had the TV on, and I was well aware of the news about the UFO. So I said, I'm gonna jump in my car and I'm gonna go down Lincoln Drive past Squaw Peak and see if I can see what's going on. When I got here, there were people milling around, just enjoying the park. And I was here for probably 5 or 10 minutes, and somebody said, look at that, and out to the northwest, this great big massive craft, probably around 3,000 or 4,000 feet, took out a whole chunk of the sky. And you could see other aircraft in the distance, but airplanes looked like little toothpicks compared to the size of this craft. And it came right at us, made not a sound, and just moved almost sort of gently and smoothly, not that fast. It just glided over Squaw Peak. And we had a magnificent view of it silhouetted.
Governor Symington observes the object for nearly a minute before it speeds away across the valley.
It just all of a sudden disappeared. You know, I've served in the U.S. Air Force, and I've been flying all my adult life. I've never seen anything like that before. It obviously had unbelievable aeronautical capabilities, something way beyond anything we have in our inventory, that's for sure. But I thought I best be quiet about it because I'm the governor, and if I go start talking about it, it's going to create more hysteria, and one should not lose sight of the fact that I have a state to run.
Symington maintained his silence throughout his second term. But now, nearly 15 years later, the former governor draws lessons for all public officials.
I think as far as government is concerned, we're sort of driven to always have an explanation for everything. And it's hard for government entities to say, you know, I don't know. You know, like we can't explain it and admit to complete vulnerability. And now I'll ask but I learned a hard lesson about this subject based on personal experience. Public officials need to be more open and more courageous in dealing with issues like this. We need to deal with it legitimately and objectively. And if we don't know what it was, I mean, you should say, we don't know what it was. It's time to square up and do the right thing.
The particulars of what was seen that March 1997 night are still avidly debated. And the Phoenix Lights case remains unsolved. But what is not in question is the case revealed an urgent need in UFO study, an official government process for receiving and investigating reports.
As it stands now, for people in the United States, there is no official body for them to go to if some kind of event takes place, which they feel needs to be reported. And what's interesting is that in terms of the aviation community, the FAA has actually told its employees in its manual that if they see a UFO, they are not to tell the FAA about it. So they're actually saying right in their manual that we, the U.S. government, do not want to hear anything about UFO sightings.
pilots and people in the aviation community in particular make excellent witnesses. But very often, when they see UFOs, they don't go on the record because they fear that their careers will suffer.
And it's a real problem because it makes the case harder to report, and it really limits the available data on the phenomenon.
Without an official agency collecting sightings, coupled with the ridicule surrounding reports, it is impossible to accurately record the frequency and magnitude of UFO activity. But particularly in the aviation community, this risks a grave safety hazard. If these unidentified flying objects are real, mid-air collisions with our aircraft could be catastrophic. Less than a decade after the Phoenix Lights, these issues are brought to light with the alleged incursion of a UFO into one of America's busiest airports.
Several pilots and United Airlines workers swear they saw one, a UFO.
Definitely was not an airplane as we know it.
UFO reports have exploded across the internet, making it more difficult than ever to weed out the credible from the questionable. In response, a handful of experts are applying rigorous investigative and scientific standards to evaluate evidence of this phenomenon. One of these is veteran journalist Leslie Kane.
I've been looking into the UFO subject for about 10 years, always focused on the hardcore factual information. Radar evidence, the photographic evidence, the physical evidence that have been studied in laboratories, and not on more conspiracy-oriented material that's floating out in the culture and all over the internet. In January of 2007, I was struck by an amazing story that was on the front page of the Chicago Tribune. A number of employees of United Airlines witnessed a disc-shaped object. It looked like a metallic disc hovering over the United Airlines terminal, specifically over gate C-17. And this was at rush hour, a busy afternoon around 4, 4:30. It was seen by a lot of people on the ground. It was seen by pilots, by crew members, by managers, by people that were moving planes around. It was estimated to be about 22 to 88 feet. And they said that it was hovering over gate C-17 for at least 5 minutes. And then the thing suddenly just shot up, directly up through the cloud bank above it and cut a crisp hole through it, very clean, like a cookie cutter. The witnesses, trained aviation professionals, were confounded by what they had seen.
I've been at O'Hare for quite some time, and I'll tell you definitely it was not an airplane as we know it.
The O'Hare case adds to the growing mountain of UFO data, echoing the common characteristics of earlier UFO sightings. It was a disc-shaped object that hovers silently and accelerates instantly to unknown speeds. But the most critical piece of evidence is yet to be revealed. Several months after the incident, Kane obtains a copy of the control tower tapes, which includes a never-before-heard recording of a United Airlines supervisor calling in to report the sighting.
Okay, I'm sorry. What can I do for you? All right. I told Dave there was a disc flying outside above Charlie 17, and he thought I was pretty much high. But I'm not high, and I'm not drinking.
Yeah.
Someone actually has a picture of it, so if you guys see it out there.
A disc? Like a frisbee?
Like a UFO type thing. Yeah, okay. Okay.
This is, you know, very, very important evidence. It shows that there was something there, it was reported to the tower, but it was still treated like some kind of a joke. And I believe that that's at least partly due to the FAA policy of discouraging UFO reports. Even though this was in restricted airspace, a busy airport in the middle of rush hour, and nobody knew what this thing was going to do. I mean, this was a serious hazard. So the FAA initially didn't say anything. But once these tapes were released, they had to say something.
Under public pressure, the FAA releases a cursory explanation 2 months after the sighting.
Well, the first thing that the FAA told people was that this was some kind of light reflection off the bottom of the cloud bank. They said it was the airport lights can do funny things on the clouds. But the problem is the airport lights had not even been turned on yet. The second explanation that the FAA gave was that it was a weather phenomenon, most likely what is called a hole punch cloud. A hole punch cloud is a natural phenomenon that is caused by ice crystals falling from above a cloud down to a cloud bank below and melting a hole in the cloud. problem is you have to have freezing temperatures for this to occur. Well, we know for a fact that it was too warm at O'Hare that day. The temperatures were not below freezing at the level of the cloud bank. So it is an absolute physical impossibility for that event to have been caused by a hole punch cloud. Ultimately, the O'Hare case and the FAA response to it are typical of how the U.S. government handles UFO sightings. First, they avoid having to talk about it at all, but if that becomes impossible, the authorities will just throw out whatever explanation they think might fit, whether it's plausible or not. And it's a real problem. This has happened countless times for decades. It's a standard operating procedure for cases like this.
Despite the current situation, there was a period in U.S. history where open scientific study was encouraged, and sightings were actually welcomed by the government.
For the past 3 years, a large number of perfectly sane and reliable people have been involved in this flying saucer business. We read about them, talk about them, wonder about these reports of strange phenomena in the skies.
I'm inclined to believe that it's of an extraterrestrial origin.
Back in the 50s and 60s, there were a lot of sightings that were being reported. There was a lot of coverage in the media, and officials could not figure out what was going on. And it was during the Cold War, so there was heightened concern in the general public about unexplained things in the sky. So the U.S. government set up an agency within the Air Force called Project Blue Book, and its purpose was to take reports from the public and to investigate cases.
Project Blue Book officially launches in 1952, with its five-person staff receiving over 1,500 reports in the first year alone.
I was driving north on 101 Highway at about 3 o'clock in the afternoon.
I noticed a terrific blue flash past nose of my airplane.
I looked to my right, and there in the sky were three tubes of fluorescent light.
And it went over me, practically right over my head.
The object traveled in a straight line. I counted eight of them, proceeding directly out to sea.
And I began to hear a hissing, whistling sort of a sound.
A beautiful, silvery, pink-tinged moonlight.
Between 1952 and 1969, Blue Book receives over 12,000 UFO reports, nearly 800 of which are unresolved. It is soon clear that the scope of the UFO phenomenon is far greater than the small Air Force office can handle.
Blue Book was plagued from the start. It was understaffed, incompetent in certain ways, and eventually it just became like a public relations exercise for the Air Force. So in 1966, it was decided that its future would hinge on a government-funded study commissioned at the University of Colorado.
The university study is headed by Dr. Edward Condon, physicist and former head of the National Bureau of Standards.
Condon was biased against UFOs from the beginning. In fact, in a 1967 article, he was quoted as saying, "My attitude is there's nothing to it." But I'm not supposed to reach that conclusion for another year.
The Condon report is completed in 1968 and includes some valuable analysis of unresolved UFO cases in its nearly 1,500 pages. But that goes largely ignored in favor of the two-page summary written by Condon himself, which declares that further scientific study of UFOs is unwarranted. In 1969, the Air Force announces the termination of Project Blue Book, effective the following month. Since then, the report has been cited countless times by officials and scientists to justify dismissal of UFO study.
It's really a tragedy. I mean, this was the only official investigation by our government. When it closed, the golden age of UFO study in America was over.
Since 1970, many cases have challenged the assertions behind the close of Blue Book. But a 1986 sighting near Anchorage, Alaska would produce standout evidence that demands to be taken seriously.
Yeah, this is 1-2 again. On some other equipment over here, we have confirmed there's a flight size of 2 around here, 1550 squawk. It looks like he is, yes.
In this case, a captain with 30 years of flight experience puts his reputation on the line by reporting an enormous craft that follows him for nearly an hour. An encounter that would yield the longest recorded data of a UFO to date. Hard evidence that would be brought all the way to the White House.
They were all excited about it. So I said, "What do you think it is?" He says, "Well, it's a UFO."
My name is Richard Haynes, and I have been a research scientist
for NASA since 1967. My interest in unidentified aerial phenomena goes back 30 years at least. When I was a skeptic, I was just quite convinced that I could explain the phenomenon. But I had an opportunity to talk with commercial pilots who would come in to fly our simulators. And once in a while, a pilot would tell me this remarkable story that it had happened to him. And over the years, I began to realize that I was wrong, that I could not explain the phenomenon. So in the 1970s, I began collecting face-to-face pilot interviews, sometimes in the cockpit of the airplane. Sometimes we would refly an actual encounter. And so far, I have collected over 3,000 sightings from virtually every country of the world, and quite a number of them were very serious. These would qualify as near miss by FAA standards. And so, looking at air safety as our concern, we formed NARCAP, the National Aviation Reporting Center on Anomalous Phenomena. NARCAP is a reporting center for pilots and air traffic controllers who would like to make a report of their sightings in a completely confidential manner. This is very important because a lot of pilots are afraid for their careers. They believe that they will be ridiculed, and the implication is that if you see something in flight, you're not competent to fly the airplane, which is absurd. We've got to turn that situation around.
Yeah, this 1-2 again. Some other equipment here. We have confirmed there is a flight size of 2 around here, 1550 squawk.
Where is he going?
It looks like he is, yes.
In 1986, NARCAP learns of a sighting near Anchorage, Alaska that would become one of the best-known pilot cases on record. A key investigator on this case is former FAA Division Chief John Callahan.
I was the Division Manager for the Accidents, Investigations, and Evaluation Division, FAA Headquarters. The rule was if anything came up that was newsworthy or it was an accident, we had to know before the smoke cleared. Sometime in January of 87, I received a call from the Alaskan region. Apparently a UFO had chased this Japanese 747 across the skies for like 31 minutes. Somehow the media found out about it, and now they want more information. They didn't know what to tell them. I said, tell them it's under investigation. I told them to package up all the data, the voice tapes, the computer tapes, the military tapes, and send them overnight delivery on the red-eye flight to the FAA Tech Center, Atlantic City.
Callahan assembles a team of FAA analysts who synchronize the radar with the pilot's radio transmissions. The result is recorded on this video by Chief Callahan and becomes an essential clue in unraveling the case.
Captain Kenju Teruchi, a senior captain for Japan Airlines, flying a 747 cargo flight from Paris to Tokyo. He saw a military test of some advanced nature.
When he looked at his airborne radar, he saw a large target 7, 8, 9, 10 miles in front of him. And the first thing he did is he called the FAA and wanted to know if they had any traffic up there for him.
Air 1628, sir, if you're able to identify the type of aircraft, and see if you can tell whether it's military or civilian.
I've been 1628, but we cannot identify the type, but we can see navigation lights and turnover lights.
Viewing this one-of-a-kind radar evidence, Callahan's team is able to confirm the unidentified target near Teruchi's plane. But it is this never-before-heard interview conducted by Dr. Haynes with the Japanese pilot that illustrates the extraordinary details of the craft.
What he told me was remarkable. It was a huge object, something far bigger than his own airplane.
Big walnut shaped, as large as three or four aircraft carriers, had lights coming from it, and small craft coming and going from the bigger craft.
How long did it take to move from the 12 o'clock position?
Captain Teruchi made no excuse for being afraid. He said he was fearful. The captain and his first officer were expecting a collision and were bracing themselves. That's how serious this was.
The Anchorage controller clearly takes the sighting seriously because his next step is to confirm the unidentified target with nearby Elmendorf Air Force Base.
Okay, it looks like I am getting some search primary return. I don't know if it's erroneous or whatever, but... That is firm. We do not have anybody up there right now.
The military guy sees those targets. The controller working the radar sees these targets. According to the pilot, there's a great big ship out here, and that stays with them for a while.
Jupiter 1628 Heavy, someone requests you make a right 360-degree turn and advise me what your traffic does then.
As Captain Tarucci was approaching Fairbanks, he received permission to carry out a 360-degree turn. He wanted to try to get away from that object that was on his left-hand side. His supposition was that the object would continue in a straight flight, and he would bank to the right and leave it behind.
Yeah, this 1-2 again. Some other equipment over here. We have confirmed there is a flight size of 2 around here, 1550 squawk.
Where is he going?
It looks like he is, yes.
As Tarucci continued the 360-degree turn, the object traveled around the circle with him, which is very interesting because it has to be going faster than that airplane to keep up. So the phenomenon had to be under good control, perhaps intelligent control, to maintain precise station with that airplane.
The pilot sees it, his co-pilot sees it. The military base and the Anchorage controller track it on radar. And a United Airlines passenger jet flying nearby also reports unknown traffic in the area. In all, the Alaska sighting shares many characteristics with the most credible UFO cases, including Rendlesham, Phoenix, and Chicago. It is a massive disc-shaped object that moves as if under intelligent control and is capable of accelerating instantly to unknown speeds. And most remarkably, the encounter lasts nearly 55 minutes. Over a span of 350 miles, providing the FAA with significant amounts of data.
They had the analysts put together a chart that would explain every hit around the 747, and even a blind man could see there was a target there. But I'm thinking it's the stealth bomber, figuring who believes in UFOs.
When Callahan returns to Washington, a meeting is arranged with the White House scientific team to review the materials.
There was three scientists from Reagan's staff. There was three guys that said they were with the CIA. And I played the tape three times for them. When the video got done, they were all excited about it. They're drooling. They can't wait to get their hands on all this data. This is the first time they ever had more than a few minutes of radar data to go through. And then the CIA guy, he steps forward and he says, this event, pointing to the TV monitor, never happened. We were never here. We're confiscating all this data, and you're all sworn to secrecy. So I said, what do you think it is? I'm still thinking it's the stealth bomber. He says, well, it's a UFO.
2 months after Callahan's meeting, the FAA releases an official explanation for the sighting, which, like the Phoenix and Chicago cases, seeks to explain away the phenomenon.
They said it was a split beacon. It was a ghost target. It was ring around. It never happened. But the Japanese pilots do not see ghost targets. They don't see ring around. They don't see split beacons. We only see a dot or a slash on radar. You have to rely on the pilot telling you what's there.
Captain Tarucci decides to go public with his encounter at great personal risk to his reputation.
Because of his willingness to fill out the forms and be interviewed in great depth, Japan Airlines decided that he should no longer fly. And so Captain Tarucci was asked to fly a desk, as they say.
This case illustrates what's at stake. Until the U.S. government changes its policy on UFO sightings, witnesses are always going to be afraid to come forward with critical and important evidence.
This is how science progresses, is to allow people to openly and honestly describe what they're seeing. We're never going to get to the bottom of this phenomenon until we have an open disclosure.
These days, if you go on to sites like YouTube, you'll see all sorts of videos of UFOs, and there's a huge amount of fake videos, photos which have been mocked up with various computer programs. I mean, it's almost impossible these days to pick out the signal from amidst the noise.
And the only pictures that are really important are the ones that have been so thoroughly analyzed and vetted that we know that they are a genuine unidentified flying object.
One of the most viewed UFO videos on the web, with over 17 million YouTube hits, is this clip, claimed to have been shot in 2007 in Haiti. Along with other recent images submitted online, it has UFO watchers buzzing. But with advances in special effects software, it is becoming more and more difficult to distinguish between real and faked images, making experts in the visual effects community a valuable voice on the subject.
I'm Doug Trumbull. I make movies that have to do with science fiction, special effects. I worked on 2001 A Space Odyssey, Close Encounters of the Third Kind, Blade Runner, Star Trek The Motion Picture. And so I do motherships and spaceships and UFOs for a living. We have a situation right now where everybody who has a laptop can make a fake UFO. I can make a fake UFO on my cell phone. I mean, it's just all over the place. My personal belief is that I'm convinced that there is something very real. But I've never seen a photograph that I couldn't duplicate or fake digitally or optically or photographically and make it look just like that. And so I'm my own worst enemy in that respect because I know what's possible.
On break from his latest project, Trumbull shares his opinion on the authenticity of the 2007 Haiti video.
I think it's really good. I don't buy it as a real UFO or UFOs. But I think it's a pretty well-done special effect because they're doing very dynamic camera moves. They're matching the irregular movement of the camera to the movement of the object. They seem to have kind of aircraft-like ballistic trajectories that all kind of make sense, like they're flying in formation. But there are a number of things happening here that kind of give away the illusion to a certain extent. Let me just freeze on this. You know, look at these two palm trees. They're identical. That frond, this frond, that frond, that frond. These are actually a photo composite of one palm tree put in two places. So it's really the same palm tree twice. That doesn't happen in nature, it's absolutely impossible. There's other things that happen, like when this thing goes through the trees, even though this seems to be an extremely bright light, it's not affecting these fronds at all. There should be more light happening up in the fronds of the tree. So you'd get a little twinkly light and some interaction, but there isn't any, because that's a much harder thing to do. So good job, but I don't buy it.
While vacationers with video cameras may stumble upon irrefutable proof of UFOs in the future, there are already images of the phenomena that have been scientifically tested and widely accepted. The Belgian sightings of the late 1980s and early 90s are some of the most widespread in history, with over 2,000 well-documented and researched reports by pilots, police, and military professionals.
I thought this is an intrusion of our airspace. We have to find out because it's an air defense issue.
The 18-month epidemic of UFO sightings rattles the Belgian government and brings the scientific community its most conclusive piece of UFO evidence to date.
I look at it and said, oh my God, that's too much. My feeling at the time, I must admit, it was a fake.
This is the Belgian wave.
My name is Patrick Ferrin, and I was one of the two co-founders of SOBEPS, which is a non-profit association devoted to the study of aerial space phenomenon. In 1989, the situation was very quiet here in Belgium concerning UFOs. So quiet that we decided to close the association because there was no sighting anymore. And all of a sudden, strange things started to happen in the area of Ubland. And this was, historically speaking, the beginning of the Belgian UFO wave.
My name is Albert Kreutz. On the evening of November 29th, 1989, I was the dispatcher at the Eupen police station.
At around 5:30 p.m., a team of police officers informed Kreutz of an object flying over a nearby field and reportedly lighting it up like a soccer stadium.
I joked with them, since it was the end of November, that it was St. Nicholas coming down. Then they screamed, "Look out your top floor window, and you'll see it." I go to the window, and I see the object about 200 or 300 meters in front of me, like a boat floating in the sky. It was magnificent to see, and it made me think that we are not alone on this earth, in the universe. I found it beautiful.
Immediately, the dispatcher is flooded with calls from concerned citizens. So he orders local officers stationed nearby to follow the object. One of these is Dieter Plumens, Chief Inspector of the Kelmis Police Force. Plumens is on duty with his partner, catching drug dealers near the Netherlands border, when the call comes in.
When we heard the call on the radio, we were driving in this direction. We saw a light or some type of object resting over the town of Henri Chapelle. And we asked ourselves, what is that?
I told them to pursue the object and observe it. So they followed it to Henri Chapelle. The object hovered motionless over the Beloeil retirement home.
I think this is pretty much the exact spot where we stopped at the time. We saw a huge object above us with round lights on three corners. And at some point, a much smaller object flew out from behind. And it had a reddish blinking light that blinked in rhythm with the larger light.
Plumens and his partner observed the objects for several minutes. And then suddenly, the red orb is reeled back into the larger craft.
Das Objekt.
The object then rose up and flew away.
Kreutz and Plumens' accounts are among the many that began to flood in that night. In all, a total of 13 police officers called in reports of an unidentified triangular craft spotted in 8 different locations around Eupen. Over 60 additional civilian reports are made that evening, producing a concentrated mass of sightings that would soon bring international media attention and compel the Belgian government to respond.
It was really an historic night because the sighting reports were also similar. But the big surprise was that this was only the beginning.
Des personnes affirment avoir vu longuement et à plusieurs reprises des objets volants et lumineux de forme triangulaire.
Ils ont vu dans le ciel un phénomène étrange, un ovni.
The day after November 29, it was a huge covering in the media.
Le résultat des interactions entre les forces cosmiques.
It was on TV. It was in the newspaper everywhere. And immediately, we took our car and we went to Eupen to interview the people who saw it. We collected 150 different sightings from the same area, describing almost the same thing. A huge triangular dark object.
Avec chaque extrémité, un grand feu blanc.
C'est vraiment comme départ d'atterrissage d'un avion, bien beaucoup plus beau. Pas comme ça, j'ai une chance.
Et au milieu, celui-ci, un gros clignotant rouge.
What is very interesting is that triangular object wasn't reported at the time, in 1989. At the time, in ufology, people were speaking about flying saucers, discs, something like that, but not a triangular dark shaped object. This was new.
The Belgian sightings of November 29th garner international attention, prompting an immediate response from the government. A point man is assigned to head up the government inquiry. Major General Wilfred de Brouwer, head of operations for the Belgian Air Staff.
In 1989, I was in charge of protection of the airspace of the country when a total of 143 sightings were reported in the area of Eupen. When receiving such report at military level, a lot of officers will reject it because it's not in their terms of reference. It's frustrating. It's frustrating having to declare that you don't know what is going on. So when it came to my office, I wanted to react it the same way, but I thought this is an intrusion of our airspace. We are the country hosting NATO. We have to find out because it's an air defense issue.
De Brouwer's first action is to contact the U.S. Embassy to find out if any stealth flights had taken place in the area without warning them.
Now they came back very quickly and confirmed formally that no such flights had taken place over Belgium. So that wiped out that theory.
But the sightings continue, including many cases where several people were involved in a single sighting. Police officers, military and government personnel, and an Air Force weather forecaster.
Highly credible witnesses, all of them convinced that they saw something exceptional.
One of the cases that most intrigues de Brouwer occurs just 2 weeks after the initial sightings, when several witnesses report a triangular-shaped craft near the rural town of Ernage. De Brouwer is particularly struck by the account of Colonel André Amand, a civil engineer who is also director of infrastructure for the Belgian Army.
Je quittais la maison.
I was driving from my house, my wife by my side, to go pick up my son at the Gembloux train station. I noticed three yellow panels moving parallel with me beside the road. Under them was a pulsating red light. I did not understand what it was. My wife said, it's probably just a plane. But I wanted to see it, so I slowed down. And the object stayed with my car. So I accelerated and slowed down two or three more times. And every time, the UFO would catch up with me. Then the UFO traveled behind the Sarnege woods. So I turned left and stopped on a small hill in front of a farm. The UFO came out from behind the woods over there. I saw a huge, bright white beacon come over until it was about 100 meters in front of us. You could hear traffic on the highway and a train going by about 1 kilometer away. But at no point could you hear any noise coming from this object only 100 meters in front of us. We observed it for 6 to 8 minutes. And then my wife says, André, come on, get in the car. I don't like this. And at that point, the great white beacon retreats and it darts away to the southwest in about the time it takes to let out a breath. In my experience, that kind of acceleration requires a very large amount of energy that wouldn't be possible without materials that could superconduct at a low temperature. And today, 20 years later, I know one thing. There is no man-made object able to do what I saw that object do that day. Not then and still not now. It's impossible.
Colonel Amand sends a report to the Ministry of Defense and is one of the many military professionals who convinces the Belgian government action was necessary.
We decided to set up a procedure to launch, in the future, aircraft to try to identify these sightings, but on conditions. First of all, witnesses would report to the police. They would confirm the sighting, and then they would call a radar station which had the authority to scramble F-16s.
I am Eve Mielberg. In 1990, I flew F-16s in the 350th Squadron in Belgium. We had heard about the wave of UFOs, particularly in the regions of Liège and Eupen.
On the evening of March 30th, 1990, Mielberg's unit is informed of a string of UFO sightings around the town of Leuven.
We immediately took off in formation, two F-16s flying east of Brussels. Our goal was to intercept or come as close as possible to the objects and try to identify it as best we could. The speed at which the object was moving, the large variations in altitude and course, were particularly unique. In air combat, we're used to seeing objects move very quickly. But in this case, the object's variations were unforeseen, which proved that we were dealing with an object very different from an aircraft.
Voilà, ici vous voyez le vecteur de l'objectif 300 degrés, vitesse 990 nœuds. Bon, la vitesse de l'avion normal à cette altitude est l'ordre de 350-400 nœuds.
Under pressure from a hungry press and public, De Brouwer holds a press conference to discuss Mielberg's flight.
Voilà, ça c'est une vitesse de 1010 nœuds. Donc ça, c'est la vitesse maximale qu'on a enregistrée. The F-16 is registered objects that were flying at a normal speed, but suddenly turning and accelerating to speeds which were much higher than the speed of sound. Now, this cannot be done by any conventional aircraft.
Donc les accélérations ont passé de 150 à 500 nœuds dans une fraction de seconde.
Fortunately, only one of the F-16 radar tapes provided sufficient information to analyze, which meant that we couldn't compare the tapes to exclude electromagnetic interference, which is a reflection of an object, sometimes on the ground, that can go through the atmosphere and bounce back to the F-16 radar.
100% sûr que vraiment il y avait quelque chose.
Due to the failure of the secondary radar recording, government officials cannot verify the pilot's account, but Mielberg's remains convinced.
Personally, I believe there was an object at that location that day. We had ground witnesses, radar stations, and airplanes. Three different sources watching the same object at the same time in the same place. There was something in the air that night.
The individual sightings of the Belgian wave are remarkable and impressed De Brouwer and other investigators with their legitimacy.
But what they didn't have was something irrefutable, a piece of evidence that would bring this fully into the realm of science.
On a spring evening in a village not far from where it all began, this evidence would finally arrive, and the results would be more than they had imagined.
My feeling at the time, I must admit it, was a fake.
More than a year after the Belgian wave began, UFO reports continue to flood the office of SOBEB's co-founder, Patrick Ferrand.
For almost 18 months, we collected massive observations, and we met several hundred people. We collected something like 60 photographs of unidentified flying things, and almost the same amount of video film. But unfortunately, they're all very bad. All you can see with small dots of lights on a dark background. But we were lucky to find one good picture. And this picture was taken in the small village of Petit Rochin, which is not that far from Eupen.
The 4th of April, 1990. At 10 o'clock in the evening, a girl was walking her dog in the garden, and she saw a very strange object. She came back in and told her boyfriend, we have something strange here, can you come and have a look? And he went out and he took his camera. He only had two pictures left, so he leaned against the wall, didn't move at all, and set an exposure time of about 1 to 2 seconds.
He took two pictures, and when he got his film developed, he saw that one of the two pictures was blank, there was nothing on it, so he threw it away. But the second one was interesting. He saw three lights and something reddish right in the middle, but that was all. I received the original at the time. I looked at it and said, oh my God, that's too much. My feeling at the time, I must admit, it was a fake. So I built a small model and I tried to reproduce what was on the slides. And I immediately understood that it was not a model. So we decided to see someone who was an expert in digital analysis, someone who had the right tools to detect and to prove it was a fake or not.
The slide is put under an intensive year-long study by Professor Mark Ashua, a nuclear physicist at the Royal Military Academy in Brussels.
Professor Ashua's analysis of the blue component of the slide show that one side of the triangular object is perfectly in focus, but two other sides are blurred. This proves that there is an independent movement of the object.
It was not a fake.
The slide is further analyzed by scientists around the world, including Professor André Marion, a nuclear physicist at the University of Paris Sud.
Professor Marion discovered that there was a magnetic field around that object because he observed a pattern like iron filings behave in a magnetic field.
Professor Marion's findings trigger speculation that the craft may have moved using a magnetoplasma dynamic propulsion system, an electrically powered engine that uses a magnetic field to generate thrust. Such a system could also account for the lack of wind and noise reported by witnesses.
In the history of UFO study, the Petit Richard photograph stands out as one of the most convincing pieces of evidence of a sighting to date. Not only does it reinforce thousands of reports from across Belgium, but it reveals many shared attributes of the most credible UFO cases.
It is a triangular craft that moves silently and accelerates instantly to unknown speeds.
And what's interesting about the Belgian sightings is that we in the UK had a very similar wave of sightings 3 years afterwards. Many of the witnesses talk about a large triangular-shaped UFO with three lights on the underside of the craft and a larger, slightly dimmer light in the center. So it's clear that in both cases, governments are looking at this and are coming to the conclusion that we are dealing with a real phenomenon.
The Belgian wave is remarkable not just for the sheer number of sightings, over 2,000, but for how well they were reported and officially investigated.
It lasted for almost 18 months, and all of a sudden, everything stopped.
Of the 2,000 reported cases, 650 were investigated, and out of the 650, 500 remain unexplained. The question remains open, what is it? And I don't know the answer, that's for sure. I can only say what it was not. It was no aircraft, no helicopter, no blimp, no zeppelin, no ULM, no RPV, you just name it.
The Belgian wave remains a mystery. And even now, 20 years later, witnesses are left with more questions than answers.
I'm frustrated, because after 20 years, no one has a valid explanation.
Indeed, there were two objects in the sky. We have no other explanation.
I had never seen such a flying object before that day or since then. And to this day, I still don't know what it was. Is it something extraterrestrial? Could be. I can only say what I saw.
For the thousands of witnesses in the Belgian wave, and many others who have documented their encounters at military bases, major airports, or in the skies above our cities, there is but one conclusion. There is something out there, and we need to take it seriously.
The difficulty, of course, of studying UFOs, if in fact they are manifestations of some advanced civilization, is that we are more or less in the same position of, let's say, laboratory mice attempting to understand the civilization of biology technicians in the laboratory. It is just beyond our imagination. And Arthur C. Clarke said that sufficiently advanced technology is indistinguishable from magic.
History is filled with accounts of new phenomena, poorly understood phenomena, that have been ridiculed, made fun of. Why? Because science hasn't had a chance to look into it, or won't look into it for various reasons. We've got to turn that situation around.
We have this propensity in our culture to ridicule UFO sightings. It's a problem, and we need to be more mature about it in this country.
You know, it's not all aircraft lights and weather balloons and hoaxes. There is a genuine phenomenon here, something that the scientific community should want to look at. It should want to engage on this. I mean, it potentially, it has incredible things to teach us.
We have to keep in mind that our civilization is only about 40,000 years old, which is a blink in the lifetime of our galaxy. So we are babes in the woods. And with 200 billion stars, that adds up to an enormous number of planets, including, we now know, Earth-sized planets. So the potentiality for life out there does seem to be very great indeed.
We have very, very sophisticated analytical techniques that are being used all over the universe now to look at planets, stars, nebulosities. But started asking myself, well, has anybody done a really sophisticated, technologically astute approach to photographing UFOs so that you could really get, you know, what I sometimes call the Zapruder film of UFO sightings? And the answer was no. So in that vacuum, I decided to undertake what has become kind of a hobby project for me. I've started applying very sophisticated digital motion controls and tracking technology that we use in special effects, some of which we developed during the making of Close Encounters, to try to photograph a UFO.
Trumbo's project, known as UFOTOG, or UFO photography, uses precisely calibrated cameras and radio antennas to record images and data in the night sky. By simultaneously observing the same area from multiple vantage points, Trumbo's equipment can pinpoint the speed, trajectory, and altitude of any recorded object, and more accurately, determine if it is a conventional aircraft.
My plan is to make imagery that would be scientifically valid and that could be scrutinized, just like the Zapruder film, to where really good scientific photo-optical analysts could look at them and say, well, this is exactly what happened.
Taking a 2-second dark exposure.
And I think over the next few years, it's just unlikely that we won't encounter some evidence of intelligent life in the universe. I just think it's going to happen, and it's probably going to happen fairly soon. And I'd like to be part of that.
It's really an exciting time to be involved with UFO research. And there seems to be greater chances that we're going to capture even more solid data. But we also have to be extremely careful to hold it to the absolute highest standards.
In these, the most credible UFO cases of our generation, we have heard firsthand accounts that defy dismissal. A NATO base commander, an FAA division chief, decorated pilots, police officers, a former governor, all have put their reputations on the line to deliver testimony that they at first were unwilling to accept. Together with the evidence collected, from radar data to photographs to never-before-heard audio recordings, these sightings present a case that cannot be ignored.
It's the accumulation of overwhelming evidence from pilots, generals, government officials that prove, in my opinion, that we have an actual physical phenomenon that has not been explained. It's time to embrace this information and the new reports much more openly.
The command pilot of this particular flight, he was scared to death. He's not sure what it was.
It was the shape of a boomerang.
Huge triangular object.
As large as three or four aircraft carriers.
And it came right at us, made not a sound.
It definitely was under some type of intelligent control.
It's coming this way. It's definitely coming this way.
Three tubes of fluorescent light.
Dark gray oval.
Like a UFO type thing.
It looked like someone poked a hole in the cloud.
Just all of a sudden disappeared.
There's no doubt about it.